As you see, the scarlet on the screen. So, but I'm sorry to say, any Scarlett Johansson fans here? Yeah, I'm not going to talk about Scarlett Johansson. No, the movie lost in translation, so sorry for the disappointment. So it's about something that I'm passionate about, how to engage with the language. Language is something that I've always had a peculiar fascination. So I work as a teacher, a translator, and a writer. So today, I'm actually trying to get you out of this labyrinth. I mean, people, we always get lost in languages. So let's just start. Okay, before that, I'd like to talk a little bit about the movie Lost in Translation, which was released a decade ago. So basically, what happens in these movies, two strangers meet in Japan, one an aging actor, and then Scarlett Johansson, whose husband is working as a photographer in Tokyo. So both of them are like quite lost in life, two lost souls. So they meet in this foreign land, and what happens is like they try to build this connection in this unfamiliar land. So what exactly is lost in, how does it feel to be in a situation where you feel lost? I think there are many reasons. One thing is the cultural alienation. Now, like Isura said, like even the rural kids, like when they move into Colombo, they feel this culture shock. So it's kind of like that when you move abroad, let's say like to a country where you don't know the language. So language is the main key to communicate with the people, the natives of the country. So what happens is, when you're lost, you need a way to communicate and get in touch with the people. So that connection, this is how what I'm trying to do here, that is like how to help you all build the connection through language. Yes, what does a translator do? So as a translator, I can't do this, but this is something that a translator should have a knack in thinking in two different languages, or maybe more. So basically, like, I mean, I would like to correct the speak into think. So if you are a native Sinhalese speaker and you are doing Sinhala to English translations, you should be able in Sinhala and, you know, think in two different languages. So basically, like Chuck Norris, you can speak French in Chinese. So this is something interesting, because translators, there is a dying interest towards languages. Now, if you check the number of students who select languages for A-levels, it's declining. It's a more female-centric stream. So, I followed this French by BF, DELF exams in Candy, Alliance Française, and there were like only two or three boys from Kingswood. And it was sad to see, like, because there's like a, you know, a very poor attitude towards this stream, because they think that, it's languages. What else can you do with, are you like, if you're planning to migrate to France, that's fine. But why do we need to learn a language? I mean, it's just art stream, which is usually a stream that looked down upon. So yeah, translators in Sri Lanka, they offer two degrees at University of Kalaniya and Sabaragamu. They have a BA in translation studies. So it's not a necessity. Like being a translator, like it's one of the most sought after jobs in Sri Lanka, but like unlike Germany or any other European country, even Turkey, like almost all of the documents have to be translated into their native language. In Sri Lanka, it's not a problem, because we use English as a working language in government and private. But only like when you apply for a visa, you need to get birth certificate translated. So there are professional translators who get that job done. But still, translating is not an easy job as people think. So because I work as a freelance translator, and they demand, okay, can we have it in 2 days, maybe in 2 hours? But it's not easy as it sounds. So let's see how complicated and difficult this job is. Yeah, cries in Spanish. This meme, any of, have you seen this? None? Okay, there's one. So yeah, this is from a Spanish Mexican drama. So the subtitle is clearly like a failure, because you could see that you cannot translate emotions. Even though it, as ridiculous as this may sound, you should be able to think and emote in a foreign language. Like let's say, like for example, like when you watch a sitcom or when you watch a YouTube video which is totally foreign to you, sometimes you don't understand why these people even laugh. So that's because like you don't understand the cultural context. Like sometimes we crack joke in Sinhala and maybe or even in English, but if you don't understand the context, it might seem like, why do they even laugh at this? Why is it like, is it that funny? So it's something like that. The translation, one of the reasons you get lost in a situation where you don't understand the language because you don't understand the cultural context. So to be a really good translator, you should be able to accurately, you know, decode all the references. Now let's say, now there is a English idiom called pulling the leg. So in Sinhala, kakuleng adina is something like, you know, ara diunuwata baada karna wage ekak. But pulling the leg is, you know, you are like cracking a joke, being mischievous with your friend. So this is the thing, there is a confusion, so you have to sort that out. I have been through this. So when you go to Allianz, so like Goethe Institute in Germany or Sasakawa, where they teach Japanese, there's a strict rule, they're not allowed, you're not allowed to use English or Sinhala. So even the questions, you have to struggle and make up something and ask it. So when the French teacher talks to you in French and you don't have a clue what the F is going on, you just nod, we know, and then you manage to say something, you know, escape. So yeah, this is exactly that you get, the look that you get when you're lost in translation. So it's not about this foreign Germanic Latin languages, but even I think people have experienced this, like people have been through these situations where you go to a maybe a meeting and all of a sudden someone throws a corporate jargon at you which you have no clue of. So this is something like we call it basically, and this Andrew Davidson has developed this software where you can generate corporate gibberish. Love using big words to confuse people. I think the main reason that people feel lost in translation is because no one likes to give simple, like, information succinctly. So they all want big words, you know, take a thesaurus and replace the simple words with complicated words. So why don't you try this out? I mean, it's really fun when you look, have a look at it. This is like a fake company. So for tech companies, and if you need the write-up, all you have to do is, you know, make it sound really sophisticated. So it's really fun. I tried it out. So then, yep, Google Translate and fan subs went wrong. These are the few moments where Google Translation and fan subtitles have gone. So yeah, this I think must be a recent movie because Salman Khan's there. Now in Sinhala, angili gahanda pa kiyanne, it's something like that. Maybe in, even in Hindi, they use the same thing. Fingering is not the same. Well, yeah. So it's... Your hair is ripe. I mean, konde pahila, but we never use English. So this is another failure in translation. And anime, any anime fans out here? Yes. So yeah, I came across this and I was confused whether this, because I've watched a few anime, like anyone know the show Jano? Yeah, because I think it's actually I took it from Buzz, so you can always check it out.
Yeah, so how can you say you love her if you can't even eat her poop? So these are like real translations, okay? But fan subs, that means like fans do it voluntarily. I mean, they give their own translation. But the thing is, again, this is a problem with the cultural context. It's like translating something you say it in Sinhala. I mean, you have your own colloquial slangs, no? So imagine translating that directly into English. I mean, I recall yesterday, so we were having this Twitter interaction. I think this person, Shenok, was saying, asking and applying Marmite on your backside. So I mean, imagine translating that into anime, like a show that which has a global audience. So it's kind of awkward. Who gets this meme? Meme. Someone who has a basic knowledge of Arabic. Anyone knows basic? Yeah, okay. So, wow, this meme, the letter M in Arabic. So, I mean, I don't think, so this is the thing. So you all look confused because you don't get this. This is why cultural context is important when you do translations. You need to know, you need to think in a way that the person who reads it, the audience, it has to reflect his social media. Now, I could go on talking about Arab jokes or, you know, Arab YouTube videos and anything, but if you do not understand it, you will look bored, lost, confused. So this is where you have to be really careful when you speak to an audience, crack jokes, or even do translations or transcriptions. Je de flufli, this is how Joey speaks French in Friends season 10, I think, if I remember right. So, the best thing about learning a language is trying to speak gibberish, which is like, it's an easy way of, I don't know, maybe like showing off. He does it in a French way, so that...
Third time, let's see. Sorry about that.
Speak loud enough, I think. Yeah, okay. So yeah, this is Joey. So now I'm here to get you out of this labyrinth. I'm going to share a few techniques and methodologies like in language learning. Oh, one thing, language is like maths actually. So it requires the same abstract thought, the logical thinking to decode, decipher and break the patterns and, you know, find your own way of constructing sentences. You can't rely on Google Translator or all these dictation software and these, you know, you have these text-to-speech recognition softwares, but you know, it's not 100% reliable because these Google Translate, I mean, it's a very useful tool. You have to admit that it's useful. But when it comes to translating functional, meaningful sentences, you need a human being. Because even though it's time consuming, you have to value that. Because it's a talent. It's a knack that people are born with. So the first thing, the best way to learn a language is the cultural immersion. So, I mean, we all watch TV series, we listen to music. Remember Despacito? I think when I entered, they were playing Despacito. Anyone knows what Despacito mean? Or does anyone remember the lyrics? If you listen to that song about 5-10 times, more than 5 times, you will eventually remember the lyrics. But even though you don't know what it means, still it rings in your mind because you don't have to. It's something that comes out of you, from your bottom of the heart. In Sinhala, you use the term bokkem menawa kiyana, so that's what you need when you do translations. You have to have that familiarity. So yeah, muchachos, narcos, I think all of us, most of us must have learned a lot of Spanish from Ricky Martin, Shakira, and even Escobar, Netflix Escobar. But the sad thing is, I think we pick up the bad words quickly. Yeah, so why do people like Spanish so much? Because I figured that, I mean, it's just a personal observation, most of them love Spanish. But because I think it's the force, the aggression, the you can curse well in Spanish. So if you say, yo soy Pablo Emilio Escobar, and then como mierda or something, it's the best way to attack a person. But don't misuse a language. There are so many beautiful slang. Okay, and this one. Again, Korean K-pop and Korean dramas are quite popular in Sri Lanka. And one of the reasons that, every year I think there are Korean exams and about 50,000 people sit for the Korean exams. This is for like migration, like business, job opportunities. But people, like fans of K-pop and Korean dramas, learn language, out of admiration towards their idols. So, you know, it's like very, this kawaii culture in Japanese, like people watch anime, know the kawaii culture, they pick up words. They love to learn the language. So this is something which I learned, babo. So next time you call your loved one, babo, remember it's silly, you idiot in Korean. And Italian is also something that we are familiar with because we go to restaurants and, for me, like the first time I was in a cafe or an Italian restaurant, I was quite intimidated by the menu because you have no idea how to pronounce these things. But now I think there are plenty of Italian restaurants, so almost all of us know the basic, like mozzarella, pizza, so things like this panini, it's something normal, yeah.
So another technique that I use is for my students that I make them, since they spend almost all the time on the internet, I tell them to subscribe to a YouTube star from a different country. I mean, in this case, French. Normand fait des vidéos and Cyprien has about 11 million follower base from all over the world, and not just Francophone countries where they speak only French. So once they got 10 million followers, they started adding subtitles to their videos. So please check it out. Really good. And this is the best way to learn French, not just French, but to learn other cultures, their humor. I mean, they talk about the mundane things in life. They make fun of their own Frenchmen. So it's really nice and it's very addictive. And okay. So yeah, so in the global age, you have plenty of language learning tools that can, you know, accelerate your learning and spruce up your knowledge. So what's the Elvish word for friend? You know, anyone, I mean, have at least attempted learning Dothraki, Valerian? Because I had a student who complained that learning French is really hard because why? You have to memorize the gender of every word because that's masculine and feminine. But then again, German is even more complicated because there's a third gender, all neutral. But he, the person who said that, is learning Valerian, High Valerian, because he loves the Targaryens. And then to see that it has four genders, I think lunar, solar, terrestrial, and aquatic or something. So yeah, four genders. But why do they do this? That comes from, just hold on, I just forgot to tell you. I skipped a bit. Yep, sorry. I'll go on to this, sorry. Can you skip it? Three or four slides? Yeah, so let me just talk about cultural immersion. Why do we need to watch movies and listen to songs? Because that's the easiest way to grasp the language and the subtleties of the language. The nuances, the pronunciation, the innuendos, the metaphors. It's the easiest way. And since people do it out of passion and enthusiasm, you don't have to, you know, exert extra energy, or you don't have to learn things by heart. So it's a very effective way of learning a language. And yeah, so language learning tools. So this is my favorite, wordreference.com. It's an offline app. Even online you can use it. So the best thing about the Word Reference Forum is there is a, I mean, you can post your questions. So sometimes you realize that the person who is, let's say, if it's a future tense or something, pronouns or something in a particular language, people post their questions. And it's almost all, it's very similar to the questions you have, frequently asked questions. And then Lange is a very useful tool for the translators. Duolingo, on the other hand, if you want to start learning a language, start with Duolingo because it's very interactive. And there's a lot of animation, flashcards and stuff. And then Babel, which it's quite old app, but it's really good. And use Pinterest, apart from YouTube, Pinterest and these software. You can also, I think the best way to learn a language is Instagram and YouTube comments. Because this is something which I figured out, I discovered. I wanted to learn a little bit of Turkish before I went to Turkey. Turkish is a really difficult language for me. So what I did was, just the survival French, I started following a couple of Turkish Instagrammers. And then what I did was I went through all the comments. So from the comments I learned, because if it's a nice picture, they used to comment Chok, Guzal, Muhtazim, so I used to note down them. So now I know how to compliment. So this is how you have to always find a situation. So now if I want to, like, I mean, I use them a lot. So these are the things, skills. Now it's not skills. These are techniques that you can use, it's not boring. Rosetta Stone is another software trusted by CNN, NASA, BBC, because it's a paid software. So it has a lot of features. But if you can, please, I mean, it's worth it. So please follow if you are interested in learning languages and updates, you know, the new features of the Rosetta Stone software, you can follow them up and they share some interesting stuff. So as you see, Kofefe, I love the thing that they have written below. These tweets are often short-lived and have a tendency to disappear in the morning, which is quite true because he deleted it. Oh yeah. So to end it, Yeah, you have to celebrate the romance and the sonority of the language. By this, what I mean is, like, you have to love the language first. There are people who start learning a language out of, you know, necessity, like, okay, I just need to pass the exam. I didn't have any alternative, so I selected German or Chinese. But you have to celebrate, because for me, I don't think that learning a language is for O levels. So you can pass the exam, get a good grade for the language, but if you do not love it or live in the language, it won't last long. It's like, you know, it will be dead very soon. So a few techniques that I would like to share to love and live the language. One thing is the cultural immersion thing, and the other thing is always, like, try to just enjoy it. Like, try speaking gibberish in different accents. That helps a lot. You don't have to know the language, don't worry. Like, embrace the mistakes, flaws. Sometimes I do that. Now, I'm not good in Arabic, I'm not good at all, but this is a technique my father shared. You know the Sinhala sentence, Valluro Bimaharati. He said, if someone can say that in Arabic, if someone can master that, saying that sentence in Arabic, you know, Arabic is a piece of cake. That's like Valluro Bimaharati. Like Valluro. Like, what's a Uro? It's like Uro. So you will, if you really need to, like, master that technique, follow General Aladdin's Aladdin, okay, not Aladdin. So General Aladdin's Arabic. You can, you know, imitate, impersonate. It's kind of like stereotypical. Like, we see these stereotypical languages, like Italian is supposed to be very, you know, they drag a few words. So, and when it comes to Arabic, on the other hand, you have a lot of guttural sounds. And then German, on the other hand, is very stiff and serious. So it'll be like, you know, what comes to your mind when you say German? A Nazi, or, you know, Hitler, or Heinrich Himmler. So it's very, like, stiff and serious. It's like expressions in Deutsch. And if you go to German, you can't be as romantic as you were in France. So it'll be, like, really serious. So these are the, like, cultural differences and things that you learn. So yeah, like to play this. Scene from Matrix.
Take time, how can we ever have time? Chateau Aubryon, 1959, magnificent wine. I love French wine. Back, I love the French language. I have sampled every language. French is my favorite, fantastic language. Especially to curse with. Nom de Dieu, de putain de bordel, de merde, de saloperie, de connard, d'enculé de ta mère, you see. It's like wiping your ass with silk. I love it.
Well, yeah, so French is supposed to be a very romantic language, but in this case, he used it to be, like, you know, I think he uttered like 10 curse words in French, but he said it in so subtle, romantic way again. Okay, there's like a final video to end this with, but before that, I'll tell you a few, like, when you travel, so you don't have to travel to a country to learn a language, to engage with the language. Now, like, I remember when I joined Twitter, like, that was like 6 years ago. Before I started following anyone, I thought of using that platform as a learning, to learn, improve my language. So I followed this French university student called Kevin G. So we joined this virtual community where a Filipino, a Japanese, and myself. So we started learning French from him. So we had this Skype sessions and, you know, like, informal chats and stuff. So through that, you know, we improved our French a lot. So I'm still grateful for him and another person called Mathieu Boudet. So this is the thing, you don't have to physically, you know, cross borders and, you know, spend like 3 or 4 months there to immerse yourself in that culture, learn the language, because I know it's not practical. Like, it's expensive, but with all the facilities that we have now, it's just a click away. I mean, but only thing is the constant touch is needed. So I remember, like, I started learning Spanish. My Spanish is not good, so what I'm trying to say is survival Spanish. So last year, I took about 2 months my time every day to practice a bit of a Spanish. So what I did was on YouTube, and like I said, the Instagram, the words that I picked up, I started conjugating verbs, because I went through the conventional way of taking a book, writing down the verbs, but it didn't work. Because I remember after all that work, I went to Spain, in Barcelona, I forgot what left and right is. Then I felt like, you know, it was such an embarrassing moment, because I felt like all my hard work went down the drain. But somehow I managed to, you know, at least use what I learned from Narcos, just a couple of words, but I managed to do it. But then again, what you can do is, now some people feel reluctant to speak their language because they think, the natives are going to, you know, it's a you know, intimidation as well as timidness. So the best thing to overcome that is, don't feel shy. What I did was, when I see this impeccably dressed men in the metros, or like, you know, when I feel like, you know, when I feel bored during my walks, I would just stop by, interrupt them, and, you know, pretend to be like I'm this curious, you know, enthusiastic person who loves their language, their culture, and I would say like, por favor, and, you know, show my map to find the, I would like, you know, pretend that I'm lost, just to, you know, spark a conversation and learn something. And they're really nice, they would help you, because if you speak in their language, they will stop their work, take their phones out, you know, guide you to the hotel where you want to go. It was fun. Even though you have Google Maps, it's not as fun as, you know, asking the directions from a native. And I did that, you know, just as an act, but it worked. And then you can continue a conversation. Maybe they might, you know, things could happen. Yeah, so this is what I'm going to end with, the same thing. Dialog means leave the language, so I'm ending the session now. Just one thing, one of my students who learned French for 3 years, so he didn't do it, you know, with passion or anything, he just wanted to pass the exams. So after 1 year, I meet him and he said, Melodeak matakane, I have forgotten everything, but I know one thing, I know to flirt with a French girl when I go to Paris next time. I said, but you said you have forgotten everything. To see that, in French, to ask someone's name, I mean, that's how you break the ice, it's kelle votranom. So, you know, when I see a kellak dakkot, I can say kelle votranom. So this is how people, you know, remember things. So I hope you learned something useful. Any questions? Thank you.